When in human history the big empires collapse, always something remains after them. Such as when the East African first big society, the Egyptians, failed, the paper still remained with us, still today. After the Greek society failed, and this is when Russia comes in. Two priests from Greece, two priests, Cyril and Methode, walked north to educate the barbaric people, and they went to Russia and they taught them to read and write, and religion was brought to them too. This is how the Orthodox Church was established in Russia, based on the Greek culture. And Cyril taught them to read and write, and this is why they still use the Cyril letters, the Greek letters, in Russia and in Bulgaria. And they were very strictly involved with that music that in ancient Greek they use. And this stayed because of the religion, very strictly, fundamentally, in the Russian society for centuries. They were not interested in the Renaissance, the Baroque, the classical European music. They were keeping everything in the church and in the Russian folk music. Also, these Greek scales that they had, no leading tone and plagal cadences, this is the main characteristics of Russian music, stayed there and for centuries. And this is the story when in the Romantic period the composers find out, we have beautiful music, why don't we use that for classical music? And you know, Ruslan and Ludmila by Glinka was the very first big Russian success, and Glazunov, and after the Mighty Five, Balakirev, Borodin, Rimsky-Korsakov, Mussorgsky, and Cesar Cui, those five who were raised up as composers and educated in Russia and wrote Russian music using the Russian sources from the church, where the bell is the most important instrument, and you will hear in the third piece that we will play for you that very important characteristics of Russian music. And the plagal cadences, no leading tone, very, very special, unique vocabulary that nobody used. But before we play the very first dance for you, because I would love you to listen for those all characteristics that makes this music different than all others, and we are extremely lucky to have that culture today for the human musical vocabulary, with this very, very profound and very strong aesthetic experience that it brings through to all generations all over the world today, we have to see how did we got there. After Beethoven, there's a big problem. Nobody knew what to do, because he himself, from the first symphony till the ninth, did a so huge development that composers were in big trouble. So what to do now? We are not Beethoven. We can't continue with that development. They didn't know what to do. There was a big question. How can we write now music after Beethoven 9, when he even brought music to that level that every human being must be brothers and sisters and forget every fighting? It's a beautiful statement. Nobody put in music that until him, and he used the music for that, and he unified literature, music, and politics together. It was perfect. Nobody could do that. Franz Liszt was the first who started to think, and driving in a wagon between Paris and Weimar for 35 years, reading Goethe's Faust for 35 years, reading the same book, he came up with the idea, let's do what Goethe does. Let's try to depict the inner side of the human being. Let's forget the musical forms. Let's forget the melodies. Try to go for the inner side rationally. And this is that Wagner continued, and this is that after Wagner, Richard Strauss continued, the German rational inner side. But the Russians came up with a different idea, and Mussorgsky is the key for that. Said, why don't we depict our inner side emotionally? How do we feel about certain impressions of and pictures of an exhibition, the morning above the Moscow River, and why don't we use national dances, national melodies for an opera, such as this dance that we just play for you right now, the Gopak. He wrote for one of his operas that unfortunately he hasn't finished with, because he was very sick, he had nerve problems, and he was in hospital, and at that time, for the nerve attacks, they didn't have any medication. And he just started with something and after couldn't finish and did another one. And after Rimsky-Korsakov and Cesar Cui, they finished with his music because they thought he was a genius with this. Even Ravel and Debussy said, without Mussorgsky, we wouldn't be that composers that we are. And he thought a Ukrainian dance would be, the Gopak, would be perfect for that opera because it's very Russian, totally different than anything else. And if I would have the chance to depict it there while we are playing it, I would love you to see it because it's fantastic acrobatic. The dancers, the Kozakan are certain fighters, military on the horseback in Russia. It's an extremely acrobatic dance. While they are dancing, they're almost on the ground and their legs are in the above of their head. I don't know how they do that. Maybe they need to practice with a little vodka. I don't know how they do that, but it's just fantastic. Let's listen for that, and I hope you will enjoy that. Mussorgsky's Gopak. So this is a kind of character that was new for Europe. Nobody thought about that. And his friend, Hartmann, he had a nice series of drawings that when he saw, he got lots of ideas. Wow, I got so many different impressions when I saw, different emotions coming from just those pictures. And this is when he wrote the pictures of the exhibition, a series of movements, a suite for piano. And Tushmalov, his student, made the very first orchestration for orchestra. Ravel made it famous because he loved it too, and nobody played the Tushmalov arrangements because in Russia they played it once and after they thought, oh, it's okay, and they forgot it. And after Ravel said, wait a second, it's a wonderful piece, he made it very famous, and after we realized that Tushmalov did a really good job with that. And today the Ravel orchestration is a rental material, it's very expensive, and the Tushmalov is much more cheap because we can buy it. So I thought, why don't we do that? Well, it's cheaper and excellent, and this year, first time in the history of UCF Music Department, I am that lucky that we have an assistant conductor who works with the group, and my assistant worked very hard, a very talented young gentleman, and this is the last time in his studies that he can conduct the orchestra, so I thought it would be nice if I will offer him and ask him to conduct this piece. And he prepared very hard. I know him already for more than 10 years. since his graduate studies in Tallahassee, worked always very hard. I don't know how he does that. Band, orchestra, marching band, everything, teaching. I don't know, I have just 24 hours in a day. He must have 36. I don't know how he does that, but he does so many things. So I thought I will invite him to do this piece, and he will do a great job for you all. Please welcome our graduate student, wonderful, young, talented conductor, Jason Milhouse.
Thank you. Thank you.